Very good morning. Hi, I am Dr. Janak Patel. Today I am going to talk on palpitation. You know very well, palpitation is a very common symptom in a young individual as well as the person who is suffering from a cardiovascular disease. Palpitation may be totally non-pathogenic to a severe disease where the person can have a sudden cardiac death. So we are going to deal today with palpitation. So you can see in this particular picture, there are two different people showing you the presentation of palpitation. We'll be discussing under the heading definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment and complications. So palpitation by definition means awareness of own heart beating. May be defined as awareness of the heart beating, commonly brought about by rhythm, rate, or augmentation of contractility. This particular three pathophysiology will have palpitation. Change in rhythm, change in rate, and change in force of contraction. Do not forget that palpitation does not mean heart disease. It can be without any heart disease. The degree of palpitation is not equal to the severity of heart disease. Because you can understand very well, our anxiety state always exaggerates the palpitation. And in the anxious person, there is a lower threshold at which the disorders of rate and rhythm can result into palpitation. Opposite of that, a persistent tachycardia and atrial fibrillation may not be accompanied by a continuous palpitation. Person later on do not complain of palpitation. A sudden brief alteration in a cardiac rate or rhythm, which often causes considerable subjective discomfort. Do not forget yourself, palpitation when your patient has palpitation, most of them are benign. In family practice setting, no difference in the rate of morbidity or mortality among the patient with palpitation compared with the matched controlled subjects. Hence, all palpitation are not arrhythmias and many arrhythmias do not palpitate. Remember this. Etiology wise, we can divide into cardiac, non-cardiac. And further division, symptomatic, asymptomatic, good number of time, the cardiac disorder may be absolutely asymptomatic. Palpitation may be for a temporary period or may be for a longer lasting. Longer lastings are usually cardiac arrhythmias. Temporary are usually non-cardiac causes. It may be because of arrhythmia or it may not be because of arrhythmia. So it is called non-arrhythmic. It may be absolutely physiological like anxiety. Or it may be pathological like in a case of a cardiac arrhythmias. The commonest cause of cardiac arrhythmia may be a drug induced or maybe a cardiac disorders. While another big group we call as a psychiatric group, which are usually symptomatic and they are without any arrhythmias. So pathophysiology wise, we already told you that it can be because of augmentation of the heart contractility like LVH or RVH, which is commonly because of valvular heart disease, arrhythmias, maybe tachyarrhythmia, bradyarrhythmias or other arrhythmias, other varieties. And another big group we call as anxiety or we call cardiac neurosis. Etiological classification wise, you can classify according to arrhythmia, psychiatric causes, drugs and medications, non-arrhythmic cardiac causes, extra cardiac causes, etc. And if you see in this particular slide, 43% of palpitation are because of cardiac causes. Almost parallel to that, psychiatric groups is almost 31 and of unknown etiology is 16. Miscellaneous group is 10%. So a good number of causes are non-cardiac, that is psychiatric and unknown etiology. They are non-cardiac groups. The most common cause of palpitation is because of cardiac arrhythmias, and those you can include as tachyarrhythmias, bradyarrhythmias, extrasystoles. In tachyarrhythmia, supraventricular tachycardia, paroxysmal atrial tachycardia, PT, atrial flutter fibrillation, multifocal atrial tachycardia, AVNRT, that is AV nodal reentry tachycardias, AVRT, that is atrioventricular reentry tachycardias, classical example WPW and LGL syndromes, and even in case of a Brugada's, long QT, short QT syndromes, ARVD, arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. All this will result into tachycardias, which may be intermittent or which may be persistent. In case of bradycardia, the most common cause is sinus node disorders, that is sick sinus syndrome, AV blocks, complete heart block, SA block, sinus arrest, etc. In extrasystole, ventricular premature beat, atrial premature beats. These three accounts for arrhythmic groups. While, because of augmentation of a stroke volume or increased force of contraction, there is an RVH or LVH which results into palpitation. They can be ASD, VSD, PDA, which are congenital heart disease, acquired heart disease, rheumatic heart disease, AS, aortic stenosis, aortic regurgitation, mitral regurgitation, mitral stenosis, mitral valve prolapse, hypertension, cardiomyopathy, congestive heart failure, etc. Even in case of a non-cardiac groups, you can have a palpitation because of increased stroke volume, which is like anemia, thyrotoxicosis, pyrexia, AV fistula, Paget disease, etc. Absolutely non-cardiac group, psychiatric groups like anxiety, panic disorders, hyperventilation syndrome, diaphragmatic flutters, drug induced, etc. These are some of the causes of palpitation. There are many, many more causes of palpitations. Say this is one simple example. Atrial flutter fibrillation can be because of lot of causes. You can see a big list of the causes. It can, any one of these causes can result into atrial flutter fibrillation. Among non-cardiac groups, hyperkinetic circulations, we already told you, anemia, fever, thyrotoxicosis, hypoglycemia, pheochromocytoma, drugs like aminophylline, atropine, thyroxine, tricyclic antidepressant, vasodilator, digitalis, even your routine foods like caffeine, cocaine, amphetamine, tobacco, ethanol, tea, coffee, spontaneous skeletal muscle contraction of chest wall, mastocytosis, physiological conditions like exertion, excitement, pregnancy, neurocirculatory asthenia, Da-Costa syndrome, Effort syndrome, shoulder heart syndrome, vasovagal attacks, etc. You can see this, that even chocolates, particularly dark chocolates, can result into palpitations. Even citrus fruits. And this particular is what we call as a, which is utilized for a health, and that is called fruit. These are some of the things which can result into palpitation. Even this can result into palpitation. Yes, this is another way where you can get palpitation. When a small child is playing, this can also result into palpitation. This is also 100% palpitation. So, in a pathophysiology, we have already told you, change in the heart rates, whether tachycardia, bradycardia, irregular heart rates, like heart blocks, premature atrial beats, ventricular premature beats, or increased stroke volume or increased force of contraction, we already explained you before, and in a non-cardiovascular process. Now, when there is a severe cardiac arrhythmia, usually it will result into decreased cardiac output. And because of decreased cardiac output, lack of blood supply to brain, person can end up with syncope or sometime even with coma and severe hypotension, particularly orthostatic hypotension, because of which person can have a fall, can have a head injury. And if cardiac arrhythmias ends with ventricular tachycardia, which can finally end into ventricular fibrillation and cardiac arrest, and person can have a sudden cardiac death. So these are the three main mechanisms by which a person develops palpitation, that is alteration in the heart rate, alteration in the rhythm, and augmentation in the force of myocardial contraction. So common presentations is asymptomatic group, good number of time. Some of the people can present as an asymptomatic, particularly person who has got a chronic cardiac arrhythmias. Symptomatic group may be temporary, may be longer lasting. Temporary are usually short period, and which are because of a short episode or paroxysmal episode of cardiac arrhythmia, like paroxysmal atrial tachycardia, atrial fibrillations, etc. Because of this particular palpitation, the person who is having palpitation because of cardiac arrhythmia can end up with dizziness, presyncope, syncope, orthostatic hypotension, hypotension. Sometimes they will even develop a chest pain. They might precipitate ischemic heart disease. And if the palpitation is because of the ventricular arrhythmias, particularly ventricular tachycardia, can end up with a ventricular fibrillation and cardiac arrest and sudden cardiac death. Because of decreased perfusion, the person can also complain of shortness of breath. During palpitation, person complains of certain peculiar symptoms like fluttering, pounding, thudding, throbbing, quivering, skipping beats, my chest is going to explode, can't catch my breath, etc. These are some of the way which the person describes palpitations. When you approach to a palpitation, the most important part is a history. Then you have to examine a pulse, blood pressure, cardiovascular system, and then you go for investigation like resting ECG, ECG with exercise, ambulatory ECG, Holter monitoring, external loop recorder, internal loop recorder, and EPS, electrophysiological study. And ECHO will help you to identify the structural heart disease. And it will not be an investigation to identify the cardiac arrhythmias. For identifying a cardiac arrhythmia, ECG is very, very important, and it is a utmost requirement. To find out the etiology, like thyrotoxicosis, you will have to do T3T4TSH. When you take a history, one of the way to take a history is Socrates. Site, onset, characteristics, radiation, associated symptoms, timing, exaggerating factor, relieving factor, and severity. The best way to ask a separate questions, like one of the most important question, is it continuous or intermittent? Is it regular or irregular? What was the approximate heart rate? Does it occur in a discrete act? Onset is sudden, and how it terminates? What are the associated symptoms? Are they associated with chest pain, light headache, or polyuria? When it is associated with polyuria, very frequently it is supraventricular tachycardia. Are there any precipitating factor like exercise or alcohol? Is there any history of structural heart disease in past, like coronary artery disease or valvular heart disease? All these questions are very important to find out the exact etiology of palpitation. There are some example which is mentioned here. If a person says that my heart is missing and then I get a thump, respect very frequently because of ectopic beat, and it is worse at the wrist, again in favor of an ectopic beat, very frequently ventricular premature beats. Very fast and regular, classical example, supraventricular tachycardia or ventricular tachycardia. It is a sudden onset and suddenly it stops. Again, supraventricular tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia. Offset is with vagal manoeuvre. Very commonly it is supraventricular tachycardia. Fast and irregular, atrial flutter fibrillation. Forceful and regular, not fast. It is mainly because of anxiety. Severe dizziness or syncope, very frequently ventricular tachycardia or bradycardia. Pre-existing heart failure, very commonly ventricular tachycardia. These are the few examples which can tell you. If suppose person says that I've got a skip beats or I've got a flopping beats, very frequently premature beats, like atrial premature beats or ventricular premature beats. Sustained burst, very frequently SVT or VT. Irregular atrial fibrillation. Abrupt, supraventricular tachycardia. Gradual onset, sinus tachycardia. If it is associated with chest pain, it is very frequently because of ischemic heart disease or maybe myocarditis, pericarditis. Associated with fever, like rheumatic fever, myocarditis, pericarditis, or infective endocarditis. Associated with syncope and twitchings, very frequently because of ventricular fibrillation, paroxysmal ventricular tachycardia, or high degree AV block. Associated with weakness, fatigue, that is pallor, anemia, and maybe associated with hemorrhage and hypotension and shock stage. Associated with weight loss and sweating, very classical finding in case of a thyrotoxicosis. So indirectly, whenever you come across a patient with a palpitation, a good history, an ECG examination gives you a good idea. This is a flow chart which gives you a rough idea regarding how you approach to a patient. You can pause a slide and you can go through at your leisure time. Whenever a person has got a arrhythmias, first thing we ask is heartbeat regular? If answer is yes, try to find out the rate. If it is more than 100, it is in favor of tachycardia. Classical SVT, VT. And in SVT, VT, usually the rate is very high. While in case of a plain simple tachycardia, person usually will say that the heart rate is not much. And that is very commonly in anemia, anxiety, sinus tachycardia, and high stroke volume. While if there is no irregular heartbeats, irregular, then person will be having ectopic beats or atrial fibrillations. Whenever you see a person with tachyarrhythmias, while going through an ECG, we must answer this different question. Is QRS wide or narrow? Because if QRS is narrow, it is more in favor of a supraventricular tachycardia. And if it is wide, can be supraventricular tachycardia with aberrancy or maybe with ventricular arrhythmias like ventricular tachycardia. Regularity. Regular tachycardias, regularly irregular and irregularly irregular is always in favor of atrial fibrillation. Regularly irregular may be because of many other conditions like regular irregularities, ventricular bigeminy, ventricular trigeminy, atrial bigeminy, atrial trigeminy, etc. And when it is regular, it can be supraventricular tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia. See that P waves are present or absent. If P wave are absent, very frequently it is in favor of a nodal tachycardia or ventricular tachycardia. And if P wave are present, whether they are normal or abnormal. If they are abnormal, it is more in favor of a atrial tachycardia, multifocal atrial tachycardia, atrial flutter, atrial fibrillation, etc. And if they are normal P waves, it is more in favor of a sinus tachycardia. Look at the rate. If rate is very high, it is more in favor of a supraventricular and ventricular tachycardia. And if the rate is close to 100, it is more in favor of a sinus tachycardia, anxiety, etc. Is rate change sudden or gradual? If there is a gradual change, it is more in favor of a dangerous tachycardias. And if the rate change is sudden and suddenly it stops, it is more in favor of a non-pathogenic tachycardia like supraventricular tachycardia, sinus tachycardia, etc. So, in investigation, resting ECG, look at the previous ECG, evidence of ischemic heart disease, LVH. ECG can give you a lot of ideas, and even if a previous ECG shows a ventricular block, AV block, pre-excitation syndromes, bifid P waves, which is very common, that is we call as a P mitral, or tall P wave, etc., which gives you a good idea. And if a person was having a long QT, short QT, ARVD, or in which you get an epsilon wave, or Brugada syndrome, where you get a downstroke, ST elevation with a downstroke and T wave inverted. Some of the cardiac arrhythmia is precipitated by stress. So you can go for a stress testing, which will show you the presence of cardiac arrhythmias only during stress. Some arrhythmia which are paroxysmal in nature, you will have to go for an ambulatory ECG monitoring or Holter monitoring for more than 24 to 48 hours. And even after those procedures, if it is not detected, you might have to go for an external loop recorder or internal loop recorder or event recorders. And there is another technology we call as a MCOT, medical cardiac outpatient telemetry. And this gives you a very good idea, because whenever a person gets palpitation, he will record that and he will send it to a center which will diagnose what was the type of cardiac arrhythmia. To identify the structural cardiac disorders like valvular heart disease, cardiomyopathy, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, dilated cardiomyopathy, etc., echocardiography with Doppler will help. To find out the etiology, hemoglobin, T30/40 SH, urine for VMA, which will give, or metanephrine, urine for metanephrine, which will give an idea regarding a pheochromocytoma. If you want to find out the exact type of conduction disturbances, you might have to go for electrophysiological studies. X-ray chest is very commonly needed for a structural heart disease. During cardiac arrhythmias, if you see the response for a cardiac massage or a Valsalva maneuver, and if a person responds, it is a supraventricular arrhythmia. And even after all this investigation, still you can't identify the cause. Always try to rule out a psychiatric group of disorders and have a psychiatric opinion. So these are all the tests which can be done. And one of the most important tests is an ECG, which can detect premature atrial contraction, ventricular contraction, SVT, VT, WPW syndrome, LVH, left atrial enlargement, right atrial enlargement, long QT, Brugada, ARVD, old MI, and conduction abnormalities, even which can, like long QT, which is predisposing to torsade appointis. Another diagnostic test, we already told you, echo, stress test, and cardiac cath, or MRI, whenever it is needed, or you can combine MRI with cardiac cath. This is a diagram showing you the valvular disorders detected by echo. And whenever you go for ECG monitoring for a long period to find out the paroxysmal events, ambulatory monitoring or internal loop recorder, external loop recorders, or we call event recorders, etc. And you can go for an EP study. And you know very well, ECG can be recorded in 10 minutes, 10 seconds. Holter monitor may give you an idea regarding cardiac arrhythmia if it occurs within 2 days. If you can't detect during that time, you might have to go for event recorders, which will give you a record for 7 days. MCOT and external loop recorder will give you for more than 30 days. And internal loop recorder, you can continue for even 3 years. And this is a diagram which is showing you an MCOT. This is a classical example where the person is having a smart sensor. Whenever he gets a palpitation, he just records that, send it to a center by a wireless monitor. It goes to the monitoring center where the person, expert, diagnoses the type of cardiac arrhythmia, sends to a physician, and then physician makes a diagnosis and takes the action accordingly. Now, this is a simple diagram which is showing you a tachycardia with prolonged PR interval, sinus tachycardia with electrical alterations. And this is a diagram which shows you that there is a sinus bradycardia with premature atrial contraction. This is a premature atrial contraction. This is a premature. This P wave is abnormal. QRS complex is identical. This has come before. This was expected here. This has come before. And that is a cause. This is again another premature beat. You can see this is an RR interval. This is an RR interval. Now this has come premature. This has also come premature. There is an abnormal P wave. There is an abnormal P wave. So this is an atrial premature beat. Now here you can see that this is a ventricular premature beat. This is a ventricular premature beat. This is a ventricular premature beat. All these are of different shape. These two are of same shape. So this is a multifocal ventricular premature beat. This is a RR interval. Here premature beat is not preceded by P wave. QRS complex is wide, and this is a ventricular premature leak. And if you see the RR interval is irregular, so this is the atrial fibrillation with premature ventricular beat. Now in this, you can see that there is a short PR interval with a broad QRS complex, and there is a slight notch on the ascending leg. And this is a classical ECG of a WPW syndrome. And this particular person, because they have got an accessory bundle, they will precipitate AVRT, that is atrioventricular reentry tachycardia, and that is through bundle of Kent. This is the way they will precipitate ventricular tachycardia. And you can see in this diagram that supraventricular tachycardia is precipitated because of accessory bundle of Kent, reentry tachycardia. Now this is a diagram which shows you irregular electrical activity, which does not show you any QRS complex or so. This is ventricular fibrillation. This is showing you ST elevation with downsloping and inverted T wave, classical in case of a Brugada syndrome. And this Brugada syndrome can end up suddenly with ventricular fibrillation, and person can have a sudden cardiac death. This is a diagram which is showing you a long QT, and because of a long QT, person can develop what we call as short QT, long QT, both can end up with a cardiac arrhythmias. This is outpatient monitoring system, we call as a Holter monitoring system, when it is indicated and when, how it is helpful. So if there is no evidence of heart disease, then you reassure the person. And still, if the person is having a palpitation, you can go for an ambulatory monitoring, and you can go even for an MCOT. If there's an evidence of a heart disease, and if it is unsustained, then again you can go for ambulatory monitoring. And if it is sustained, electrophysiological study with or without a prior ambulatory monitoring is helpful, because you will be able to identify very easily the type of cardiac arrhythmia by electrophysiological study. So these are the additional studies which can be done in a person with palpitation. Once you make the diagnosis of palpitation, treatment depends upon the basic etiology. And the main importance is to prevent the complication. So you confirm the diagnosis, and always before starting a treatment, airway, breathing and circulation should be examined and should be treated first. If it is a wide QRS complex tachycardia, adenosine is usually given, but do not rely on adenosine because it is not the way to confirm the diagnosis of supraventricular tachycardia with aberrancy. Hence, adenosine should not be utilized as a diagnosis purpose. If there is a bradycardia, IV atropine, isoprenaline, etc. can be given. Glucagon can be utilized. In case of atrial flutter fibrillation, supraventricular tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia, if pharmacotherapy does not revert back, cardioversion is useful. In case of atrial flutter fibrillation, AVNRT, AVRT, if pharmacotherapy does not revert back, cardioversion does not revert back, then permanent, we call as a radio always radio frequency ablation therapy is useful. And if a person has got WPW syndrome, Brugada syndrome, long QT syndromes, RVAD or ARVD, we call it arrhythmogenic right ventricular dystrophy, in those particular group, ICD, intracardiac device, is very, very helpful. And in a case of a person who is having a palpitation because of the structural heart disease, secondary due to valvular heart disease, surgery, or what we call as a valve replacement or a valvoplasty may be helpful. In case of a supraventricular tachycardia, carotid sinus massage is useful, and even Valsalva maneuver may be helpful. in a supraventricular tachycardia with aberrancy, adenosine and IV verapamil. And as far as pharmacotherapy is concerned, beta blocker, decoxin, even amiodarone is also useful. If that does not work, DC cardioversion. If all the above drug fails, cardioversion also fails, then radio frequency ablation. So in a nutshell, reassurance, lifestyle modification, correct the comorbid disease in a person with anxiety, anxiolytic drugs, beta blockers, and if a person has got definite cardiac arrhythmias, select antiarrhythmic drugs. If that does not work, electrical cardioversions. And in a person with a recurrent life-threatening cardiac arrhythmia like ventricular arrhythmias, should be treated with a cardio defibrillator device, or we call as a ICD, implantable cardioverter defibrillator devices. And if a person who has got a bradycardia, in that case, atropine is very, very helpful. Atropine is very, very helpful. And then you might need a permanent pacemaker. Yes, common complications because of cardiac arrhythmia, it can be hypotension, syncopal attacks, and particularly in case of atrial flutter fibrillation, thromboembolism. If a person develops a severe hypotension, might develop a hypoxic damage, and in a case of a life-threatening cardiac arrhythmias, particularly ventricular cardiac arrhythmias, person can go into ventricular tachycardia, ventricular fibrillation, and cardiac arrest, and person can have sudden cardiac death. Here I end my lecture. I hope this lecture will be helpful to you. See you in the next lecture.